Hey guys, welcome back to the channel again. In this video, I'm going to tell you what you need to know on arrival to Russia. What are all the small tips that might help you after you arrive in here. Also, those who are here for specifics, I'm gonna leave timestamps in here and in the first comment, in the first pinned comment in the comment section. So you can also skip through the chapter and watch stuff that you really need and come back for more. I will recommend you to watch the entire thing because it's good for my videos. And those of you guys who are new to my channel, I'm Mohit Saravanapirumal. I'm currently a sixth year medical student. Yes, I have graduated out of my fifth year. So I'm a sixth year medical student from Far Eastern Federal University, Vladivostok. And let's get started. Let's start with arrival to Russia. I don't think most of you who are coming to Vladivostok are going to be arriving in Vladivostok directly, because most of the international routes that we usually connect through, like Hong Kong, like Japan, like Malaysia, like Beijing, all these places are currently closed for transfers, especially to Russia. And also, you can only come to Russia through a direct flight. And Vladivostok currently doesn't have any direct flights to India, even before the quarantine time. So most of you guys are going to be arriving in Moscow. This is all due to a huge COVID bubble situation that India and Russia are going through. So you need to take COVID tests 3 days before your flight, despite your vaccination status. And I guess most of you are under 18 years of age, so you might not have gotten vaccinated, but despite of your vaccination status, you need to take COVID test. That is number one. And coming to Moscow, you are especially going to be taking the routes from Delhi, because only Delhi has direct connecting flights to Moscow. You might find flights from Mumbai and Chennai as well, but I don't think it is going to be the cheaper option. Most of my friends are who have traveled last year and this year are traveling to Delhi from different parts of India and then taking the flight from Delhi to Moscow. It is either going to be an Air India flight or it is going to be an Aeroflot flight. If you are going to travel Air India, I would highly recommend you taking advantage of the student allowance. That is, if you show a student ID or something like that, the amount you are going to pay for the ticket gets reduced by a significant amount. So you can avail those student discounts. But disclaimer in here, please contact the Air India office and check if you can travel through the allowance if you are going to be presenting your admission letter. Because at that point, you are going to first travel to Russia, you might not have any student ID upon you, and that might be a bigger problem. So please contact Air India's customer service and ask them if that is enough. Next one is on arrival to Moscow, how to navigate the city. Moscow is a really huge city with multiple airports, so you might need to navigate the city either for transferring from one airport to the other, or because you are having a really long transfer time from Moscow to a different city. So navigating through Moscow is going to be really difficult if you are not going to speak or understand Russian, or read Russian for that matter. Let's talk about Russian language later, but in Moscow, use taxi apps such as Yandex and Uber. And please make sure that you are not scammed, because any foreign country, including India, for foreigners, people usually get scammed with rates of taxi and transportation. So if you're going to travel by taxi, please make sure that you are using Yandex taxi apps or Uber taxi apps. Both are going to be available in the English versions also, and please make sure that you navigate it through that. Also, airports, there are various airports in Moscow. There are they are also present in different locations, and transferring between them can be a hustle. If you have a connecting flight from one airport, but you have arrived at a different airport, please make sure there is enough time in between so that you can transfer from one point to the other, because Moscow is a really big city and the traffic sometimes can be really hard on you. So please make sure that you have enough time in transfers. Next one is the registration procedures. If you are going to be staying in a city for more than 3 days, you need to get registered with your local visa offices. That is, in Russia, it is called as OVIR, or the Russian Migration Service, RMS for short. The 3-day registration rules applies for everyone, including tourists. But if you are going to stay in a hotel in Moscow, that is going to be done for you. But after arrival in your city, please make sure that you contact your international office and your visa office first within 3 days, because you definitely need to do that, or there are penalties, or you can even be deported and you need to come back again to Russia because you have missed your registration date. So you don't need that. Please make sure that you go to your visa office and get yourself registered. Again, if you are staying in a hotel in Moscow or in different areas, different regions, if you're not staying in a hostel, the hotel usually does it for you. Please make sure that the hotel gives you the registration slip. Make sure that you ask them, or if they don't give you, make sure that you go to your local RMS office or OVIR office and you do that. If you are in a university like mine, and there are visa offices, visa representatives who can do this for you, please approach the international office and the visa office so that they can do it for you. Next one is SIM card situation. Most of the Wi-Fi situations in here need Russian SIM cards to access. For example, my university provides two kinds of Wi-Fi. One is the normal DVFU Wi-Fi, and the other one is DVFU guest for the guests in the university. The DVFU Wi-Fi can be only accessed by the university IDs, which you will get after 3 to 4 months of getting your contracts in here. The next one is the DVFU guest, which requires a Russian SIM card to activate the Wi-Fi account to get yourself registered in that. So these are the 22 options. So you definitely need a SIM card to access. So my recommendation, according to Vladivostok and according to the island situation, depending on the costs to signal ratio, is MTS and Tele2. You can either get these SIM cards in the airport or in your local shops nearby, local electronic shops nearby. There you can also find a lot of these SIM card shops all around the city, anywhere you go. So you can buy them there, but a safer bet is to buy a temporary card if you're traveling from Moscow to Vladivostok especially. You need to get a SIM card in the airport because that might make your life really easy. Next one, on arrival to Vladivostok. Again, airport to university, the taxi situation is the first place where you get scammed on arrival. Don't be that guy who spends tens and thousands of rubles after you arrive inside the city. Make sure that your first impressions of the city is going to be really nice. Do your own research. So the airport to the university, or even the airport to the city, is a really long distance because Vladivostok's airport is in its nearby town of Artyom. So the university is about 60 kilometers away from the airport. There is no direct public transport connections between the airport and the university. So there are two ways essentially, but one is the most comfortable one, which is usually the taxi route. You can use Yandex taxis or Uber. You can also use Maxim, which is the local app of choice, which I would prefer. So you can use these three apps. It is usually going to be costing you around 1500 to 2500 rubles. At the max, you are going to be spending about 3000 rubles for a 4-people car. Please make sure that if you're having the English version of the app, make sure that you tick luggages inside the additional services thing, because Russia charges you for that too in your taxi apps. Make sure that you do that so that your taxi driver doesn't argue with you for charging you more because of the luggages. It usually costs only around 30 rubles to 50 rubles depending upon the car service that you opt for. But if you're not going to tick that, the taxi driver can argue with you and you have no choice but to pay him because you don't know Russian. Next one, before coming to the university, before even boarding the flight in India or anywhere else in the world, before coming to Russia, please make sure that you contact your university. If you're going to be staying in their university hostels, please make sure that you get your room numbers and the dormitories you have to go and visit on arrival to the city, because usually if you arrive at night, it is going to be really difficult accessing international relations office and the visa offices, because they are going to be only open in the morning. So coming to the university at night without the guidance of the university administrators and stuff, or someone to guide you through, is going to be really difficult. So please make sure that you message your international office where you got your admissions from to get the dormitory addresses and the place where you have to report basically, and also make sure that you have enough roubles in hand to pay the fees, because most of our dormitories usually charge you initially when you enter the dormitory. You need to pay before you can access the rooms. Sometimes the dormitory administrators are really good that they allow you to stay without paying, and you can pay in the consecutive days, that is the next 2 days or so. But some administrators usually require you to pay. If you're not having experience in paying dormitory fees, or if you're not used to Russian language, it's going to be really difficult. So please make sure that you have enough rubles in hand, at least for 2 to 3 months. That is going to be around 12,000 rubles in hand, so that you can pay your dormitory fees and access your rooms without any hassle. Next one is going to be quarantine measures. Russia currently doesn't have any mandatory quarantine measures, but my university has quarantine measures for people arriving inside the university to maintain a bubble inside here. So when you come inside the university, you are going to be sent inside quarantine. You're going to get your PCR tested for the first 3 days or so. With the first negative result, you can come out of the quarantine. So it is not going to be that hard on you. But till the point you get the result, you're going to experience Russian cuisine, which is going to be really hard on you if you're not going to be eating any kinds of other meats other than chicken and fish, because most of the Russian soups, porridges, etc. contain beef and pork in them. So make sure that you have snacks in hand, or you contact the administrators beforehand and tell them that you can't eat all of these. Next in the list are going to be expenses. These are the things that you tend to forget after arrival. These are the things that you exclude from your budgetary list when you think about coming to Russia and spending money. So the first 2 weeks are going to be pretty expensive due to the visas and registration things that you're going to be doing, as well as paying for insurance. Insurance is going to be costing you around 4,000 rubles, just that. So the visa procedures and registrations are going to be costing you even more, and the electronics and room essentials that you are also going to be buying are going to be costing you more. Apart from that, you're going to get winter clothing, which can be sometime later, but please make sure that you keep all of these in mind for planning your expenditure on arrival in here. Also, pro tip, please carry copies of your passport, that is full copies of your passport. All pages need to be copied so that when you come to Russia, you don't have to spend on that too, because copying in Russia, especially after experiencing the copy rates in India, is going to be really expensive. I found it really expensive after coming to Russia. Also, make sure that you have enough passport size photos of yourself, because you're going to need a lot of them, and that is also a really costly thing to spend. So these are small things where you can cut down on your expenses. Another pro tip is to have offline downloaded Google translations. It is going to be really useful when you're navigating through Russia without having any knowledge of Russian whatsoever. Another pro tip might be to learn the basics of Russian language. You can find a lot of courses online, as well as YouTube tutorials which can teach you the basics. So please learn your basic greetings, etc. It is going to be of some use when you arrive in here. Also make sure that you learn the basic food essentials like rice, like juices, like bread, etc. These things are going to be useful when you are accessing a market. You can also use Google's translation app, which also provides you photo translations or live translations, where you can use it on the food item or the packet to translate the text from that. So that is also going to be really useful for you. So these are some of the tips which I thought might be useful for you when you arrive in Russia. So that's it for now. I'll see you guys in the next one. Please please make sure that you leave your comments down below and your suggestions down below, so that you can get your question answered before you come in here. I'm also going to make a Q&A session later this month or in the next month or so. So please make sure that you leave your questions down below, and I will see you guys in the next video really soon.